Welcome back to Carolina This Week. Joining me now is Vita Miller, Democrat running for State House seat 108 against Stephen Goldfinch, who you saw just previously. Thanks for being with me this
morning. Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure.
We'll talk about the issues in a moment. As I did with Representative Goldfinch, I want to give you the same opportunity to address the charges that he says never were brought against him. And he said if they had been brought against him, that it was an old issue and that it was would have been a misdemeanor charge and he would have pleaded guilty. He says those charges never came.
Well, Tim, I believe your station also did a story on that when that issue came out. And just last week, or week before last, September 9th, I believe it was, the Post and Courier did a follow-up story on that. And in that story, the U.S. prosecutor was quoted as saying there were charges and that Mr. Goldfinch would be taken to trial in Charleston, South Carolina. And this is something that we have said all along. If there are no charges, if everything is clean, for Mr. Goldfinch to produce the documents to let the voters know so that the voters can be the judge on this issue.
Okay. Let's leave that at that. We'll cover that in newscasts possibly in weeks to come and deal with it there. But here I want to talk about the issues and what people who may not be familiar with you know who you are. You have held this office before. I think it was a different district name and number back then, but basically the same area, that strip kind of connecting Georgetown and Charleston and Horry County, but doesn't go into Horry, but covers Pawleys Island, Litchfield, down through Georgetown, all the way down, as I said, to McClellanville, mm-hmm. almost Mount Pleasant. This mm-hmm. is a very strange district because you cover so many different territories.
Absolutely. And when I was in office from 1996 to 2000, the first part of that tenure, we did have part of Horry County, and they're the lower end of Garden City. In 2000, we went through reapportionment, which was just done again in 2011. And at that time, the district lines changed from Murrells Inlet to the county line, all the way down to Owendall. So now the district takes in all of that area with the exclusion of the city of Georgetown and goes a little bit further into Mount Pleasant. So it is a very coastal district with lots of communities that share common interests and also have special needs that are not related from one community to the other. So it's a very unique district, and I always thought that I was so fortunate because I felt like District 108 was the best district in the whole state.
I want to start off talking about jobs. Job numbers seem to kind of, they're on a roller coaster ride. They're down 1 month, up another month. But everybody wants to know about jobs, bringing jobs into the poorer areas of South Carolina, which District 108 includes some of the poorer areas and some of the
Absolutely.
Wealthier areas. But how do you work on what, I imagine the port would play into this. What do you see as job creation?
Absolutely, and I'm glad you mentioned that, Tim, because District 108 is unique in that we have some of the wealthiest people, I think, in the state in District 108, and probably some of the poorest or least advantaged people in District 108. So it does create a lot of unique problems. Going back prior to my service in the House, I was a member of the Georgetown County School Board, and I realized that having quality, first-class education is the key to job recruitment. These two issues go hand in hand. And I do believe that Horry, Georgetown, and Charleston counties, the areas that basically are surrounding District 108, have done a great job in bringing better education facilities and opportunities to our students. And we have, of course, across the street, Coastal Carolina, which is an A1 first class university, along with Horry, Georgetown Tech. But with that being said, of course, the port in Georgetown will play a vital role in bringing jobs and economic development to our community. I do serve on the Georgetown Port Task Force, and Senator McGill established that, now Lieutenant Governor, mm-hmm. established that committee about 2-3 years ago, and we worked with folks to bring this attention to the federal government, state leaders, and I believe we're now making some progress in funding, and I'm very proud to say that there is some funding in place that is coming through several different funding mechanisms that will go into Georgetown into that particular project. But in regard to the port, there are a lot of other areas that we need to address as far as creating jobs. And That has always been an issue that I have worked very directly with a lot of economic developments, and I will still continue to do that.
As far as infrastructure goes, talking about projects like I-73, getting a closer route to I-95 for people in Georgetown County, driven down I-17 toward Charleston recently, and parts of I-17 really need some work along there. How do you improve infrastructure? How do you improve roads and things like that? Well, would you work to do that from the
as
state?
As we know, and I think this issue has been in the newspapers, it's been reported on repeatedly, especially this past year in the General Assembly, that money is needed to address that. That our state has the eighth largest transportation system in the country, and we're a small state. We also have among the lowest gas tax of any state in the country. So somewhere in there, we have got to come up with a compromise that will allow us to get the funds that we need to address our transportation needs. Of course, the population along the coast is the fastest growing in the country, certainly the fastest growing in this state. And as a former member of the General Assembly, I did go to Washington on numerous occasions to work on the I-73 issue. I was there when we established the Infrastructure Bank, which allowed us to do 31 Highway 9 projects in Horry County. Horry County came to the plate. So it's going to take everyone working together to come up with a solution that will help us address those needs.
I asked your opponent about this, so I'm going to ask you about this too. I know he's been involved in it, and I don't know if you think it's something you should even be involved in, but fireworks in Murrells Inlet, something that's irritated some residents down there. Business owners say that they're using biodegradable fireworks. Where do you stand on fireworks in Murrells Inlet? I'm talking about the big displays that happen.
The big displays. Mm-hmm. Well, I can tell you, this issue has been one that I have been watching very carefully. I know that there have been a couple of debates over whether the fireworks and the fire department should be the restaurants should make a compromise on their position with the fireworks to allow the fire department to do some things that they need to do. I do believe that these are exactly two separate issues. I have met with the restaurant owners, and I do believe that that group of restaurant owners are proven businessmen and leaders in that community, and they know that the environment in that creek and in that area is what made their restaurant so successful. So in going into that issue, certainly I think everyone that goes there on Monday nights enjoys the fireworks. On the other hand, we do have concerns about the pollution. And I think a good solution would be to bring people together. Let's talk about it. Let's make a solution that the community can live with, that the restaurants can live with, because that's a great source of revenue, not only for the restaurants, but for the entire county during that time of year.
Last question, I ask just about every candidate who comes in here. I don't live in your district, but if I did, why should I vote for you?
Why should you vote for me? Because I think I'm the best qualified, of course, but I do have 14 years experience, Tim. I do have a record of working across party lines to get things done for the district, and I think my record proves that. In the time that I was in the House, we had more projects coming back into Georgetown County, District 108, Charleston, than we had ever had before. I don't see that happening now. I would love to have the opportunity to go back and give the people a voice in Columbia. I have always believed that this job belongs to the people. It does not belong to the politician. It belongs to the people who send you to work for them. And that's what I'd like to do. And I will take that philosophy back to Columbia.
All right. Vita Miller, Democrat, running for House District 108. Thanks for being with me.
Thank you.
Stay with us. We will be right back and talk a little bit about the anniversary of Hurricane Hugo.